God doesn't make entrance into heaven something you earn. He just, it's a gift. All he needs is a heart turning to him saying, I want your love. I want your forgiveness. I want your life.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Hey John, we had John Burke on the program back in April, right as the coronavirus shutdown was in full force. And as a pastor and the author of a book on near-death experiences, he gave us a glimpse of what heaven will be like. And he has done incredible work, survey work, with over 1,000 people that have had near-death experiences. And it was one of the top programs of the year, and I'm excited to have John back to talk further about the stories that he collected and hear his insights about near-death experiences.
Yeah, I think the message of hope in the eternal came through loud and clear from John, and certainly as we're celebrating the birth of Christ just around the corner, we wanted to have John back to put a new emphasis on the hope we have in Christ. And his research, as you said, Jim, really brought out a lot of interesting things from near-death experiences, people who were clinically dead, came back and had stories to tell. And that really is the foundation for the conversation today.
You'll better understand, I believe, what Paul mentioned in 1 Corinthians when he said, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. Hmm. And these people have seen a glimpse of that, and that's what we're going to touch on today. I've also asked my wife, Jean, to come back. She was with us last time. Jean, it's great to have you here.
Well, it's a pleasure being back. I'm very excited about the subject matter.
It puts an extra skip in my step to have you here. It's always nice
sweet.
To have you.
Yes.
And John, welcome to Focus on the Family.
Hey, so grateful to be back.
It's fun to have you here.
And I should mention, John Burke is the pastor and founder of Gateway Church in Austin, Texas. And the book is called Imagine Heaven, Near-Death Experiences, God's Promises, and the Exhilarating Future That Awaits You. It's a great book, and we'd encourage you to get a copy. We do have those here at FocusOnTheFamily.com/broadcast.
John, let's give a little bit of background for the listener who may be joining us, didn't hear the previous broadcast that we did with you. As a young man, you were a skeptic of Christianity. Your background is engineering. I get that. That's a typical combination, right? You're very science-oriented. You want facts in front of you, etc. But you did have a major event in your life that changed your perspective. What happened?
Yeah, well, my dad got cancer. And so literally death was knocking on our door. And at that time, you know, I thought maybe there's a God. I don't know. So the thing that happened is a friend gave my dad the very first study on near-death experiences. The guy who coined that term, he was actually a professor at the University of Virginia, and he heard from another professor who was doing a lecture who had had a near-death experience. His name was Dr. George Ritchie. He was a doctor, and this had happened to him, and he had encountered Jesus, and he's talking about this. And Dr. Moody hears it and starts asking his philosophy class about questions about post-mortem existence and what they thought. And about one out of 25 of his students would come up and say, that happened to me.
John, let me ask you, and you've said this to me before, and I'd love for you to tell it to our listeners, our viewers on YouTube. It's as if the Christian community, we've shrunk back from this subject. It gives the appearance like we're afraid to talk about it. But in your research and what you've done, it so backs up Scripture that you say we should be running toward these stories and explaining it to the world that doesn't understand it. And one thing you said that really caught me is we should never hand this over to New Agers or people that have different perspectives about what happens after life. This is a truly Christian area that we should talk about.
Yeah, but I struggled with that. I mean, it took me 35 years to actually write the book for a reason.
And what was that?
Well, so back to my dad gets, someone gives him this book. I see it on his nightstand, pick it up and just start looking like, huh, because he had a diagnosis of, it was terminal.
Right.
And I couldn't put it down. Huh. Mm. And I was so blown away because I thought, okay, I've always asked, you know, how do you know this stuff is real? How do you know? And here I was seeing evidence he'd categorized 100 people, and so many of them were seeing this God of love and light. So many of them saw Jesus and knew God was Jesus. And I was like, wow, could this be true? Now, I wasn't convinced right away.
Huh.
But I, within the next couple of years, ended up starting to read the Bible and got into a small group. I came to faith in Christ. And then, and I think it was God's providence, I kept running into more and more of these stories. And I just was curious, like, okay, how does what the Bible say correlate with what these people are saying?
Mm-hmm.
And initially, it doesn't always. So I am always skeptical of any one story. And I think that's a good posture to have, actually.
Let's get into some of this. What are those similarities with those experiences that you followed? And describe that research just so people have a scope. It has been over 1,000 people that you've interviewed or people that you are working with
studied,
you have interviewed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's a big number.
Yeah.
But what are those similarities that you did find? You've mentioned a couple of them.
Yeah, well, and in the book, I kind of focus on 12 or 13 of the commonalities. When someone dies, they say they leave their body, but they're in the room still. Many times they can see their body. They can see the resuscitation attempts. Hmm. They talk about how they're still themselves. They have a spiritual body, but they're still fully themselves. In fact, feel more themselves than they've ever been.
Yeah.
Remember everything mm-hmm. about their life, and they're watching what's going on. Complete sense of peace. Just feel like they've never felt so alive. Many times they travel then. Sometimes they call it through a tunnel. Sometimes it's a path, like a pathway of light. Sometimes it's instantaneous.
They're just there.
And they get to this place of incredible beauty. Not unlike Earth, mountains and flowers and trees mm-hmm. and forests, but also so much beyond mm-hmm. at the same time. And in this place, it's lit up with the most exquisite light. But the light doesn't shine on things. It comes out of everything.
Right. Isn't that amazing?
And it's not light like the light of Earth that hurts your eyes. It's light that they say is palpable. It's love. It's life. And it's light all together. And it's like it's emanating from everything. And what I've realized studying these people talking about the same places, but describing it from so many different angles. And what I finally realized is the metaphor I like to use is imagine if you lived in a flat two-dimensional world of only black and white. And that's our experience here. And death is separation, right? So when we die, our spirit is separated from our earthly body. Mm-hmm. Well, imagine being ripped off that flat black and white two-dimensional plane and brought out into three-dimensional space with colors and things you've never experienced. And you can still see your flat world because it's a part right. of the bigger three-dimensional world. But then you have to go back into the two-dimensional flat world. Mm. And how would you explain what you experienced? Right. How would you explain a third dimension, up and down, when they don't have up and down?
Yeah.
How would you explain colors when they only have black and white? And that, I'm convinced, that's where the confusion can come in.
The interpretation,
yeah. Because they're trying to describe something that truly is indescribable right. in our three dimensions
but
of space.
But like in that example of light, that's exactly what the scripture is saying, that God is the light of heaven. I mean, and you're saying exactly that.
It is, but you would never, you know, when you first read an account.
Yeah, what does that mean? What does that look like?
When you first read an account and people say, they experience this beauty and there's this mystical light coming out of everything. And there's this mystical being of light and this light is love. And you're thinking, oh, that just sounds kind of wacky. That's weird. I didn't, you know, until you really study the scriptures and you try to imagine what they say.
Yeah.
You don't know.
Right.
Well, we're going to get into some of those stories. But Gene, I wanted to turn to you and just tick off a few things that caught your attention as you and I read the book.
Well, there are many things. Yeah. I mean, there's right 10 things, but I'll just briefly list probably 5. And John, as you just mentioned, the love, the overwhelming and boundless love that people experience from Jesus, that it's a love that's so incredibly full of warmth and grace, and people describe it as being fully known and fully loved, and it's something they feel. They just feel it permeating them and coming through Jesus, the light in heaven, the beaming, brilliant, radiant light coming from and through Jesus, and that Jesus and God the Father literally light up heaven, and that people describe their senses as being so much more than what they have on earth. It's so amplified.
That grabbed me too.
Yes.
It was like you could see 10 feet or 100 miles.
Yes.
Yeah, and that's another great example. You know, the commonalities, like of the descriptors. You know, I wrote about, you know, probably 12 to 15 of the commonalities typically, but they're actually, I categorized over 40 descriptors of this mm-hmm. place and what these people said across the globe. And I actually matched them to what the Bible says. And I've got verses for all but two.
Wow. That's amazing.
And even the two. So one, and this is where when you first hear the stories as Christians, I think it does sound kind of maybe out there, weird. Like
yeah.
they will say something like, you know, there were colors far beyond the color spectrum. And you know, this light that is love and all that. Well, once you start to see what the Bible says, you realize, oh, well, that's what we should expect if we had imagined heaven.
Right.
Right. Right. But we don't. We don't really read it and go, no. What would that be like? People being able to see, you know, like they'll say, I could see miles and as right. if I was right up close. It's like, right. Well, okay, well, that's not in the Bible. Well, actually, it is. John, in the book of Revelation, is taken up into heaven. He's taken in the spirit to a great high mountain, and yet he reads the words inscribed on the stones of the New Jerusalem.
Yeah.
No, the New Jerusalem.
Okay.
You know, the foundation stones, yes. Their names written there. How did he read them?
Yeah, that's a great question.
Wow.
But they yes. commonly say this. They have, mm-hmm. their eyesight is magnified. In fact, they say that you don't just have five senses. It's more like you have 50, 100 senses, and the senses are blended.
Yeah.
So again, that's where it's like, ooh, what?
Yeah, that's really amazing.
Yeah, but if you think about it, you know, we are constrained by three dimensions of space.
That's right.
We're constrained. Right. This is a limited experience yes. of this abundance of life yes. that Jesus promised.
Yeah.
This is Focus on the Family with Jim Daly, and in the studio joining us, Gene Daly and then John Burke. John has written a book called Imagine Heaven, Near-Death Experiences, God's Promises, and the Exhilarating Future That Awaits You, and we'll encourage you to pick up a copy of that book. We do have those here at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or call 800-A-FAMILY.
John, I think we've done a good job kind of painting the picture of what data you collected and like you said, connecting it to Scripture. We can't cover all that in 30 minutes, so people need to get the book to get into more detail. But I do want to cover some of the stories because, again, they're profound. Let's start with Dr. Mary Neal, a physician. She mm-hmm. had an accident, a water sport accident. Describe what happened and what happened to her and her experience.
Yeah, Dr. Mary Neal is a spine surgeon. She was kayaking with her husband in Chile, and she goes over a fall, and it was a steep drop, and her kayak wedged between two boulders underneath the waterfall.
Right, so she was...
And she couldn't get out.
Yeah. Oh.
And she was pinned to the kayak. The force of the water was holding her down. You know, her friends were waiting for her to come up. And she's sitting there doing everything she can, calmly trying to get out. And then she starts to realize, I've been underwater too long. I can't be underwater this long. I can't still be alive. And she's, and it's pretty, in the book, I describe what she said. She said she's feeling more peace and joy than she's ever felt before, more alive than she's ever felt. And yet she's also completely herself. So she's super analytical.
Cognitive.
As a person.
Yes.
Right.
And she's sitting there watching her knees bend backwards analyzing now what's going on with my cartilage and my bones right now is, but that's not what she's experiencing. Instead, she's experiencing Jesus physically hugging her, holding her, and gives her a life review, which is another commonality,
right?
That we,
that's seeing your life go
re-experience
by.
Our lives in a powerful, profound way. Like Mary said, not only was Jesus showing me all the experiences of my life, he was showing me how everything, the things I said were good, the things I said were horrible, how he used them in other people's lives. And he showed me sometimes 10, 20, 30 people removed, how truly good comes of all things. Mm. It's that, you know, that verse of God uses all things to good of those who love him.
And how long was she dead and what happened to her?
30 minutes. Wow. So she finally dislodged about 15 minutes underwater. And then they pulled her up on shore. They started resuscitation. And meanwhile, she shoots up out of the water. And she's up above the water, fully herself, and can see them searching for her body. And she said, and this is another commonality, this welcoming committee was there. This group of people that were bursting with love and light, like it was coming out of them toward her. It was it was like this big, great party. You know, we tend to think, well, okay, there are these people with light coming out, and that's weird. But actually, that's Daniel. That's Daniel chapter 12, I believe, where he says, everybody will die and be resurrected ultimately. Some to, you know, eternal perdition, but some to everlasting light. And those who lead many to righteousness will shine like the stars forever. But Jesus said that too in Matthew 13. He said, and then the righteous will shine like the sun in their Father's kingdom. Now, what is that? Well, see, that can, if you don't really study it, and that's what I'm telling you, Jim, it really did take me 30 years before I was like, oh, okay, I see how the pieces fit.
These are technically connected.
Well,
I mean, these ideas.
We will share in the glory of God. And if the glory of God is the light that lights everything up and the love, then we are actually experiencing the glory of God emanating through us. Imagine that. Imagine getting to experience the life and love and glory of God and then being able to exude that.
So in Dr. Neal's case, going back to her story, she's watching all this. At what point does she kind of come back to her broken body and back to life? And what was that like?
Well, and another commonality, time doesn't work the same way there. And the people I interviewed in Imagine Heaven, you know, some say there was no time. Some say there was time, but it just worked differently. You were never in a hurry, and there was plenty of time for everything.
That sounds like heaven.
Well, yeah, absolutely.
No, yes. Really, time is an enemy here.
Yeah.
And you realize that. But there it's, you know, it's just like, 2 Peter 3:8, to the Lord, a year is like a thousand, a day is like 1,000 years, 1,000 years is like a day.
Yeah.
So they say the same things. Mm-hmm. So she has quite a bit of experience, but again, it sounds strange, but she was very aware of what was going on earth. And she was moving down this path that was, she described this beautiful flowers, just flowers everywhere, and flowers that were, a lot of them like you would know, but some that you don't know here on earth, and just gorgeous. Mm-hmm. Now, she lives in Jackson Hole, Wyoming, one of the most gorgeous places on earth. And I asked her, you know, well, how does that compare to heaven? And she's like, there's just no way to compare.
In and of itself is interesting. These people that have these experiences and then they're back here. It's like, you got to deal with that.
Well, they don't want to come back.
Isn't that interesting?
They don't want to come back. And many times they... you know, sometimes the Lord gives them a choice, which is interesting. And sometimes he says, no, you've got to go back. Like my friend Randy Kay, who's a CEO. So again, these people, this guy was in Time Magazine. But he had one of these experiences when he had an embolism in his leg and then sepsis, and he was gone. And he was there with Jesus in this incredibly beautiful place, and they're walking. And Jesus has his arm around him. And he's just like, it chokes me up talking, because every time I talk to Randy, I haven't once been able to talk to him without him choking up. Talking about
it's real
being with Jesus. That what they say is, yeah, it was beautiful. Yeah, my friends and family were all there. But when Jesus appeared, there was nothing else I wanted to look at. And they talk about looking into his eyes, and his eyes, it helped me understand somewhat where John in Revelation 1 describes Jesus' eyes as flaming fires of, you know, and, but they say like all the colors, like this light coming out, that's all the colors, but that look right into you and you are home. Knows
well,
you.
Think of that.
Yeah.
We're and created like, for relationship with God. Yes. That's the whole purpose of creation.
And you never want to stop looking into his eyes. Let's because go, you're so alive and so
new. Yeah. Let's move to another story. Another doctor, actually, Richard Eby. This one is really interesting because he was dead for 10 hours. I mean, I describe
crazy.
That. I mean, most people.
And he's a medical doctor
and
as
he's
well.
A doctor, right. But 10 hours? How do you even survive that?
I know.
And, what happened?
Well, so he was helping a relative move, and they were moving out of a two-story, I think, apartment, and he was throwing junk over, you know, the edge, the balcony.
The rail. I like his style
balcony.
Of moving. That's good.
Yeah, exactly.
I would have signed up
for
like, that.
Like, hey, let's just get rid of this stuff.
Whoop, over
and
the edge.
He was leaning on that railing, and he didn't realize the termites had basically split his skull open. Yeah, so he was actually, he revived miraculously in the morgue.
He was already in
the morgue.
10 hours. 10 hours.
It's astounding.
I mean, medical doctors hearing that now are saying that it's impossible, but it happened.
Yeah, it happens. And I have others who have medical records, 45 minutes, an hour, but that is
impossible.
But
what was his experience?
He just was instantly in this valley. This gorgeous valley with, you know, mountains and field and all and flowers and tall grasses. And as he's asking these questions, like he asks a question, I wonder if I can pick a flower. And immediately the answer is there. And he knows this is Jesus speaking to him. Again, another commonality is the speech is, some call it telepathic, but it's more than that.
Right.
In other words, it's thoughts, it's feelings, it's complete communication instantly, heart to heart. And so he picks it and he notices it's not watery. It's not like the cellular watery. And the voice says, of course, because Jesus is the life that flows through. He is the life of everything. So the Spirit of God, the living water of God is what flows through. We don't need artificial
It's different
sun.
Chemistry.
You don't need artificial water, which is a fascinating thing.
It is. And
even like the river of life there, you know, is the Spirit of God and is alive. And it made me realize that something that says in Hebrews chapter 8 about when God told Moses to construct the tabernacle, he gave him a pattern for it. And he said, construct it exactly as this pattern I give you, because it says in Hebrews 8, is a shadow of the real one in heaven. And it started to make me just think, is the sun and the water, which is life support of earth, just a shadow of the glory of God and the living water of heaven? That's the real thing. And this is all a kind of a shrunk down version of real life.
And a finite version
of it. A finite version.
Which I like to think about. I often think about in terms of our own ability to express ourselves, the emotions that we feel. It's almost like the Lord said, I'm going to put you in a box here. And you've got only finite ability to see things, to experience things. But it's all in the hope that you're going to lean into God, right?
Well, I think
with these finite abilities. And then, boom, heaven is infinite.
Theologically, it makes total sense. So we start in the knowledge of good and evil, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
We experience the knowledge of good and evil because of original sin. And so God, in his mercy, isn't letting us experience all of the goodness that then we would lose, or all of the evil that we could feel.
John, you know, that sounds great. And I know that there are going to be listeners that are hearing this that are having horrible life experiences. I mean, I don't know what it could be, but, you know, we know the categories: loss of a loved one, a terminal illness, diagnosis, or other pain, a loss of a son or daughter. And it's hard to imagine that it actually is going to be better in heaven, because they're feeling that pain. Speak to that concept, if you can, that the hope of heaven is what we're aiming for here, even though this life is going to really dish up pain.
Yeah.
And then what's the purpose of that pain?
So Paul says in Romans 8, I am convinced, and he's convinced from experience, that the sufferings we go through on this earth are nothing compared to the glory that we will, that will be revealed
in us. And that's
the
hopeful point.
In heaven.
Yes.
And you know, to realize, though, that relationship is meant to last forever. I think a lot of fear that even Christians have, all people, but I think even Christians have, is somehow heaven will be this mystical, even the way I've described it, you might feel like, oh, that's kind of weird and scary. Like, I don't want to be a light. I don't want to be a...
Right.
But you're not.
You're fully
This is what people say, and that's why I put 120 of their stories in, hearing in their words what the Bible says. Jesus said, you will be with me, to his friends. I will come and get you. You'll be with me. I won't eat or drink, you know, again until we eat and drink and feast together in the kingdom of heaven. Mm. And there's this great reunion. And so everything that we suffer here on earth is set straight.
John, I do want to raise the question. Some are probably asking, was it always that way? Do they always see the light? They always feel the love? But you did have some near-death experience examples where people experience darkness.
Yes.
In fact, I'm thinking of Dr. Maurice Rawlings, I think, is one of the stories. Describe what his situation was and what happened.
Dr. Rawlings was, he had grown up going to church. He was a cardiologist, but turned away from all of it in med school, was pretty much an agnostic. And a guy comes into his office and has a heart attack. And so he's doing CPR on him. And he's trying to get a pacemaker in. And every time he stops doing CPR, you know, the guy dies, clinically dies. Mm. And every time he comes to, the guy is screaming, I'm in hell. You got to help me. And the guy's describing this hellish experience he's having. And Dr. Rawlings said, it literally scared the hell out of me.
That's what he said.
Yeah, Dr. Rawlings said that. And then the guy, a third time is looking at him with terror in his eyes and saying, you have to do something for me. And Dr. Rawlings said, I'm a doctor. I'm not a priest. I can't help you. And he said, well, pray for me. And he said he realized he was so distraught that he kind of grabbed back to his Sunday school days and just said, okay, say this, Lord Jesus, I give you my life. Save me from hell. If I make it out of this, my life's on the hook for you. And the guy just said something like that with him. Dr. Rawlings didn't believe any of it.
Right.
So then he gets the pacemaker in finally. One more time, the guy clinically dies, comes back, and Rawlings was so shook up, he goes home and he dusts off his Bible, and he opens it and he starts reading, and he's like, and the next week he went, the guy came in for his follow-up, and he asked him, he said, so I want you to tell me, what was it you were experiencing where you were having, you know, you said you were in hell? And the guy looks at me and said, I don't remember experiencing hell. And he described after the time after the prayer, he ended up in this beautiful valley, the mountain valley, gorgeous, you know, like we've been describing. And he sees some of his deceased relatives and they have a conversation and he comes back. And so Dr. Rawlings then starts studying it and realizes, okay, you know, this is something real. Rawlings comes to faith in Jesus, actually, and ends up talking about it a lot. And he postulates that some of these hellish experiences are so traumatic that our mind literally shuts it out. It's kind of like when little kids are severely sexually abused or ritually abused, they block it out.
Right.
I mean, that's fascinating.
Yes.
That does raise a question I wanted to ask you, and that is sometimes in this near-death experience research, physicians will say, this may be a brain chemistry response to death. This is your systems are closing down, and your brain releases certain hormones, et cetera, that ease you into death, which will be nothing, according to them.
Right.
How do you respond to that question that, you know, okay, some in the scientific world, the medical world, will use that as the rationale for what these people are experiencing?
You know, yes, there are some explanations that may account for it was like this, okay? So, for instance, LSD, ayahuasca, these are gateway drugs, you know, they talk about, and they see colors and they have these experiences of feeling united as one with, you know, nature or whatever, which sounds similar to some of the things some people might say, but it doesn't account for the totality at all. It's a hallucination. In fact, one of the hellish experiences, who then became a pastor, he was a college professor, Howard Storm. He said, I've done all that. So in his hippie days as a college professor, he had done LSD and done ayahuasca, and he had a near-death experience. He said, it's nothing the same. It's not at all the same. But that's what people will say. Or like fighter pilot syndrome, where when they start to pull 5Gs, they will go into a tunnel. And it's like they're traveling toward this light. So they'll say, see, it's like that. Well, I mean, maybe one aspect, but not at all like the totality of the experience.
Right.
And many times that's what people are, you know, hypothesizing. Some are saying it's a hallucination due to drugs. And yet studies have been done showing that it's the same experience for those who have had narcotics and those who haven't. I mean, we're talking about in the hospital.
John, you're a pastor. I mean, that's your heart coming out of that engineering background. And this, you know, this is something God's given you a passion for. I'm thinking of the listener right now who doesn't have that relationship with Christ. I mean, we talk a lot about that. Oftentimes here at Focus, we say if we can help your family, that's one thing. But if we haven't introduced you to the author of the family, we kind of failed in our Christian mission, right?
Exactly.
So we want to do both. And I'd like for you to speak to that person right now who's listening to this going, ah, this sounds like a bunch of malarkey. You know, for me, it's excitement because I think you're putting pieces together that the Christian community, we either have lost talking about this, but it's right there in Scripture. You do a fabulous job of connecting Scripture to these experiences that people have. And I think that's the evidence I need two are together. But I want you to speak to that person who's sitting there right now. They're driving down the freeway or whatever they might be doing. They're going, what? But they're still listening because they're intrigued. But, you know, speak to their heart about what this means. This is critical.
Well, stop and think about this. You're talking about millions and millions of people all across the globe.
Yeah, not just Western European.
No. I put studies in Imagine Heaven where they've studied 500 Indians in the continent of India and compared to 500 Americans. Mm-hmm. You know, very different cultural religious upbringings, and yet what they're describing, the heaven and the God they're describing, is the same. Mm-hmm. I wasn't very open-minded. It was the death of my father, you know, that made me kind of wake up, and I think it's a sad truth that many times we go through life wanting to get our will be done.
Yeah, there you go.
Right?
Yes.
It's
all
so
of
true.
Us.
Yes.
And
that's fight.
That's Christians, that's non-Christians. We live in a world of wills at war. And Jesus taught us to pray, Father, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Because that's what's missing on earth. God, though, and this is what I think is important to realize, God is love.
Right.
The Father sent Jesus so that we would know what love looks like in our finite world. God wants relationship. And it's hard to imagine relating to a mystical spirit you can't see.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And yet God remains hidden for a while because he's teaching us something. He's teaching us how to forever choose love, how to forever choose the author of love, the God of love. Mm. But we haven't. All of us have gone our own way. All of us have chosen, I know what's best for my life. My will be done. You know, and we've inadvertently or blatantly pushed God aside. And the Bible calls that sin. It says the wages of sin is death, which is spiritual death, meaning separation from God. But this is the amazing thing. And this is what these stories reiterate as well. God, you know, God doesn't make entrance into heaven something you earn. It's a gift. All yes. he needs is a heart yes. turning to him saying, I want your love. I want your forgiveness. I want your life.
Well, and that was one of the challenges as I read the book, really. And I'll let you know, as a reader of your book, how I responded to it. Because when the Muslim encountered the light and the light said to that Muslim, this is one of the experiences in the book, I'm Jesus. My attitude was, well, wait a minute, Lord, you gave him a chance. He passed it by. Now, in this near-death experience, you're allowing him to acknowledge you. And I'm telling you, in my heart, John, what I heard was, oh, are you going to set the boundaries of my grace? I thought that was my job. Isn't that great? And well, I was like, Lord, I'm so sorry.
And you know what's funny? Dean Braxton, who is a wonderful Christian man, he had one of these near-death experiences and in Jesus' presence, and he's experiencing this love that he said, and many said this, it felt like I was the only one yes. Jesus loved.
Yeah.
Like he loved me so much and was so crazy about me and like I was his only kid. And he said, but then I would think about someone else and I'd realize, oh no, he loves him the
yeah.
same.
Yeah.
But I feel like I'm the only one. And then he had this thought, what about them? Mm. And what he was thinking is child abusers. And he said, Jesus, almost in a harsh kind of way, said to his mind, to his yeah. thoughts and his heart, who are you to nullify what I have done? Mm-hmm. And he said, when you put someone in prison, so he used his own analogy because right. he was in the criminal justice system. When you put someone in prison, eventually they get out. They get out or they die. When we put someone in hell, it's for eternity. He said, and then he said, he stretched out his arms like he was on the cross and he could see the nails in his, actually wrist, more like wrist, they would say. Yeah. And he what he realized is he wants everyone there.
He died for everyone.
He wants everyone.
It's hard to fathom that, but
That is it. It's that God has removed every barrier between us and the one who loves us, except one, our pride. Mm-hmm. In our pride, we can play God and we can say, I don't need you, God, and my will be done. Or we can just simply humble ourselves and go, Lord, forgive me. Thank you that you paid for all my wrongs 2,000 years ago so that a simple I do is all God needs.
And that's the beauty of it. Getting back to that original question, if you don't know or don't have a relationship with Christ, we want to introduce you to what it means to become a Christian. And we have many resources to help you with that. That's our core goal here, Focus on the Family. John, let me say thank you, really. Thank you for what you've done. And again, for those that are skeptics within the Christian community, I would just encourage you to open your heart up because this is what we're aiming for.
And John, that is what I would like to say to listeners, that I really encourage you to get the book Imagine Heaven, or to listen, to read it, to listen to it, because we cannot cover in these broadcasts, we can't cover the content of the book. And what the book did for me was just give me such a hope about heaven. I can't, I'm so excited.
Well,
to
and
go
love
there.
For God, you realize what the, yes. you read the words, God loves us, and it's just kind of
yes.
flat. But
right.
then you start yes. to see, oh, you feel that way about
yes.
me?
Yes. And the love that God has for humanity And the hope that this gives me for my loved ones and for everyone, that how much God desires them, wants them in heaven. And I just can't even describe, I guess, how hopeful the information in this book is. And I really want people to experience that.
Yeah, no, it's well said, Gene. I appreciate that. And John, thanks for being with us. This has been really good.
Oh, I so appreciate being here. Thanks.
Yeah.
I'm so grateful that we have that hope of heaven. And John Burke shared that message so beautifully. And as you know, we're just days away from celebrating the birth of Christ, and I can't imagine a more perfect time for you to consider inviting Christ into your life if you've not yet done so. As Jim said earlier, we have a lot of resources to get you started, a free booklet called Coming Home, in which you'll learn about God's love and grace and His invitation for you to become part of His family.
We also have the outstanding book we talked about today by John Burke, Imagine Heaven. And Gene and I so enjoyed reading through the stories and the imagery. The book really gives you a strong sense of what awaits us in heaven when we pass from this life and step into the loving arms of Jesus. 2020 has been a challenging year, and I'm thankful Christmas is finally here. We all need the hope and peace Jesus Christ came to give us. Mm-hmm. And our mission here at Focus on the Family is to remind you of that hope. We aim to give you practical tools and insights to help you be a better spouse and a better mom or dad. Let me share a story from one of our listeners. She wrote, "As long as I can remember, our family has listened to Focus on the Family. And I know my parents have been very blessed and encouraged by listening to your programs. And now as a parent myself, I find myself checking the app every day to listen. I'm just so thankful for the work you're doing. Thank you for telling the truth and not backing down on the tough topics. In these days, it's so refreshing to hear a message of hope, of help, and of truth. Keep fighting the battles and keep pursuing Jesus. And I pray that you will be thriving and even more impactful for my children as they grow up too."
Well, that is really an encouraging note, Jim.
It is, but we can't do this kind of ministry without your help. This Christmas, you can come alongside struggling families with a special holiday gift. Your support of Focus on the Family will give these families hope. And when you give a gift of any amount today to the ministry, we'll send you a copy of John's book as our way of saying thank you. Your support is critical so that we can finish the year strong and plan to reach even more families in the coming year. I know God is going to do tremendous work through you and through Focus on the Family in 2021.
Donate today and get your copy of Imagine Heaven by John Burke, and also request that booklet, Coming Home, when you call 800, the letter A and the word family. And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team here, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.